Welcome to Trading Floor. Today I'll be speaking to Christian Blaubeer from Saxo Bank about the growing politicisation of the euro crisis, housing sales in the US, and what we can expect from quarter one earnings. Christian, the euro crisis is no longer just a financial crisis, is it?
No, it has sort of spread into the political sphere, and this spread or contagion into the political sphere is really due to the lack of rules within the Eurozone as to how to deal with these issues that are currently taking place. Namely that we have all countries except one, Luxembourg, who is no longer living up to the basics of the Maastricht Treaty. How to deal with this? Should a whole new setup of rules be sort of put into the spoon and into the construction site, sort of machinery? Or should we have a sort of, okay, we'll start putting out penalties to the countries who are not living up to the rules?
But there are very clear rules, aren't there, of what they are and aren't allowed to spend?
They are actually very, very clear rules. There is the two major main rules is that you must not pass the 3% budget deficit to GDP. That was one, and the 60% debt to GDP as the other major rule. But as you know, most countries within the Eurozone has already passed both of these rules, and is now in deep red, in terms of even going higher. So the issue is really, how should you as an investor, foreign investor, have trust in an institution where all its members has broken the rules?
But I mean, it's been clear that Germany has been looking for a way not to bail out Greece.
Clearly, it has been the coalition in Germany, which is consists of conservatives and liberal democrats, and especially the liberal democrats has long been against bailing out Greece, because the main logic behind the argument is they have put themselves in this situation, now they'll put them out of the misery themselves, or the mess themselves, by good old-fashioned economic discipline. Currently, there's been a lot of pressure on Germany, because Germany is de facto the only country within the Eurozone who can afford to bail out Greece. The way it used to work during Chancellor Kohl was that major German banks like Commerzbank and Deutsche Bank was encouraged to buy some of the assets during Chancellor Kohl. It was Spain who was in trouble, so they bought some of the Spanish government bonds in order to support Spain. And the same scheme was sort of led already close to moved into action in terms of the Greece issue. But then the Supreme Court in Germany, the Constitutional Court, came out and saying that since Germany as a country has signed this treaty, the Maastricht Treaty, which is a supranational treaty, it is as if it was a German law. And as such, within the Maastricht Treaty, it says that no single country can bail out another Eurozone country. So that would be actually breaching German law if they were a part of sort of a coalition bailing out Greece. So that is de facto no-go currently.
So we're actually seeing a return to the sort of old-style political bargaining that we used to see really before the EU took control of things?
Actually, yes, we are, because it's still within the institution of the Eurozone, but de facto, since there are no rules on how to handle these issues, we are back to old political bargaining with chips in the game, chips off the table, chips on the table. But what's especially interesting is that France has sort of given up on its Europe standalone policy and let IMF in, because France realizes that they are not able to pay out the misery in Greece and Portugal themselves, because they have huge trouble on budget deficit and debt in France as well, like in all the other countries really. So I think the most realistic scenario is we're going to see a major part played by the IMF in these coming bailouts from both Portugal and Greece probably.
But this doesn't suggest that the euro crisis is going to be over anytime soon, does it?
No, actually, I foresee a prolonged period, to use Bernanke's expression, namely that this is not going to be over before summer, it's not going to be over after summer, it will be an ongoing, it may stabilize, but our call in our yearly outlook on Euro-dollar trading around 120, 122, it's definitely very, very realistic scenario now. Actually, I think we can go even lower if there's not sort of a political stance on these issues and how to deal with these issues and a sort of firm policy going forward in order to have the market regain some of its trust towards the euro.
Okay. And moving on to US housing markets, you, among with others, are beginning to say we're entering a double dip with housing sales.
Definitely. I mean, there are different signs in the US housing market that points towards, okay, this is really trouble ahead. First off, we have new home sales, which is below, now 6.4% below the prior trial. It may come up a bit here at the end of the April, where we'll see these tax credit stimulus package ending out. It usually have a boost at the end, but it'll be a short-term boost and then it'll fall back. Currently, we're seeing existing home sales actually performing decently, but that is mainly due to the very, very low prices that's currently in the existing home sales market, simply because there's an oversupply. But the main picture for the US housing market, if you sort of combine both the existing home sales and new home sales, is that we have a trend downwards in terms of price, and in terms of supply, namely volume, we have a trend upwards.
And this isn't good news because it's going to put a drag on the small and medium-sized businesses.
Yes, but at first hand, it's going to hit banks and the financial sector once more, because once prices go down, the all of the assets, sort of the asset-backed securities, will be obviously be worth less. I mean, it's just a very simple example. If you have a house, you're buying a house at $100, and all of a sudden after 5 years, it's only $65 worth. You still have debt for around $100. But you only have assets for 65, and that is actually, in a nutshell, the problem of the banks. Namely, they have inherited a lot of housing from citizens who are no longer able to pay their debt or won't pay their debt, and they have put these houses on the balance sheets for worth $100, but de facto they're only worth 65. So you should expect most parts of the U.S. financial sector going through a second round of very serious write-offs.
Okay. On to earnings. We've got Best Buy and Oracle, which are coming today. And these are going to say what about the earnings season, do you think?
They are the front runners, very front runners. Actually, the earnings season is almost, it's going to be kicked off by Intel in week 15. I think it's the 13th of April. But the point is that Oracle coming today will tell us something about as to whether companies have started investing again. I mean, Oracle is supplying databases and other software, and our main idea by looking for this is virtually what are they saying on the behavior of companies. And then Best Buy is consumers. Best Buy is an electronic chain throughout the United States, selling everything from cameras to computers and these kind of equipment. And if the consumers sort of slowly but significantly regain some of its trust towards the economic recovery, we'll see a pickup here. And that's why they're sort of the forepost, but also very important forepost. Because generally we believe we're going to see a bit surprise to the upside in terms of earnings in the upcoming earnings season for Q1. But we could see a surprise to the downside on volume or turnover. And that is what markets are looking for. Markets are looking for some revenue growth, top-line growth, in order to boost equities further from here.
Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of the growth that's come in the past has been from cost-cutting. Are you worried that cost-cutting will start to run out?
I think there's still some left, because the cost-cutting was quite significant, especially during almost the first 9 months of 2009. So I think there's still a little left here, but basically, if you look at market consensus, which I very much agree upon, we are going flat in earnings revisions, meaning that if equity markets should move significantly higher from here, that would be like 1200 level kind of thing in S&P 500, you should see a strong earnings season. I don't think it's going to come out that strong.
So you're still holding with your full year outlook that by the second half of the year we're going to be seeing a slight decline in markets generally?
Yes, I do.
Okay. Christian, thanks a lot for that.
Thank you.